Okay. So that looks okay, I guess. Great. So yeah, I thought I would just go through the sequence of works that led me to building the project that you're sitting in now. There is, I think from the very beginning of my practice, I've been interested in this idea of a kind of DIY architecture, self-made structures. And this is a project from 2007. I had an exhibition at the Seattle Art Museum in Seattle, where I'm from. And I had this kind of very, an idea kind of based in land art, or in response to Smithson, maybe this idea of like something outside the museum, like the site and on site, that the work is maybe taking place somewhere else. And I had this really intense desire to create the exhibition space as a space of longing somehow. And so my brother and I and a couple others planned to build a structure on Afognak Island, which is an island just off Kodiak in Alaska. And the plan was to go there and build something and then come back with a photograph that would be shown in the museum, and to create a structure that would theoretically be kind of like an open public space. And so we did that. We flew up there. You can see there's snow on the ground. Getting to this island alone was quite a treacherous adventure. And we cut down a few trees and slabbed them up into boards and created just a very rudimentary structure that you see there. It may still be there for all I know. So of course, like also this way of working in natural in a natural environment, working outdoors, working with trees, working with the lived living material, became really interesting to me as a way of kind of working against an idea of authorship, like maybe breaking down some of or releasing some control over the final form of the work. And this is a project for Île de Vassivière. It's like an island, again, an island in France. And here the proposal was quite straightforward: to put a block of marble into a tree and leave it there. Again, it's this kind of question of like, what's going to happen with this scenario? Does the block of marble, it's quite a thick slab of marble, actually quite heavy. Is it gonna somehow damage the tree, fall out of the tree? What could happen in this situation? It wasn't really clear when I made the piece, but now it's more than 10 years later, and I've seen pictures They're growing together quite nicely. It seems to be a fine relationship in some ways, but always like a temporary and unstable situation. So now for some of my fundamental inspiration and predecessors, I guess. This is Vanya Life from 1971, it looks like. And this is a zine, you know, that was published by a kind of nomadic group of people living in the Oregon woods, primarily. I mean, it eventually expanded. You'll see that the part of the format here is that there are topics of discussion and then responses. And so people wrote into this zine and exchanged information about really fundamental practices of living, building shelter, evading detection, evading authorities. This was a time, you know, sort of excuse me, just one second. Sorry about that. This is a time kind of, you know, around the Vietnam War and the protest movements that attended that, when the need to disappear for various different like political reasons was kind of acute. And so there's some of that going on here. And then in a kind of essential way, it's like a manual for living, this very extremely Spartan lifestyle. And for me, it also, you know, I mean, like I said, it's collectively produced. And so in a sense, it sort of predates and pre-imagines the internet, this idea of kind of connected networks of communication, but in a very analog way. And for me, like, you know, working in sculpture, you know, between sculpture and architecture, this also seemed to be a community of like common interest to the work that I wanted to do, which is sort of has to do with a different form of occupation, right? That like that Vanya Life was thinking about how to pare architecture down just to the body, really, you know, just to the bare essentials. The structures that they were building looked like the very first project I showed, the project in Kodiak. Simple shelters made out of available materials and maybe a little bit of tarp, but really as a way of bodies creating architecture. And so in a kind of analogous way, I wanted to move into the space of exhibition and inhabit that space through the process and the means of construction, right? To just like move in and start building and to change a space through that temporary occupation, to change it through my body. And always aware of the temporary nature of an artistic intervention in an exhibition space. This is Kunst Hall Bern, from around the same time there, and 2007 maybe. And this was a kind of program. There is a sort of geometric or mathematical sense to this structure that fills the entire exhibition space, passes through walls, and ultimately kind of pushed the building itself to a point of structural crisis. It's a funny story. In the process of building this structure, at a certain point, there was some concern from the institution, from the curator and the preparator, about the load-bearing capacity of the floors. And so to the right of this structure, you can see, like, you know, there starts to be a lot of weight there on these floors. And so they stopped work at a certain point and brought in an engineer who drilled a little tiny, tiny pilot hole into this parquet floor to kind of examine and do a little bit of archaeology on what exactly these floors were made of. And they found that somewhat to everyone's horror, they were made of this kind of like hollow Italian brick. And so we realized that we kind of pushed the building to its limit there. And at that point had to suspend building on the rest of that section. There was a little bit more to be added. And they went into the basement storage area and added these jacks, you know, these big kind of supporting jacks to just make sure that the floor was going to be okay. And we don't see it there, but in fact, to the left there, you see a little hole in the top left. You see a hole where the structure is passing from one room to another. And ultimately, a lot of the weight of the structure was borne through the walls. The walls were quite sturdy, these kind of, 30 centimeter thick load-bearing walls. So we sort of suspended the structure that way. This is another project of that era. And again, a kind of a system that starts to replicate and maybe kind of tend towards a kind of disorder or chaos as it encounters the architecture of the host institution. This is the ICA in London, and it passes from the gallery spaces here through the walls into the library and into the hallways and the other serving spaces of the building. And then, you know, I was also sort of thinking about like how this process of collapse could actually be the basis for building. And so I was making these structures like this one here, that kind of relied on my own ignorance about building principles, that I would just kind of start building something and build it to the point where it collapsed on itself. This is like a cast concrete beam in the center there, that's bearing onto a like a sheetrock wall. And so it was suspended from, I think you can kind of see the chain there. It's suspended from this gigantic crane above. And as the construction process was finished, it's lowered down until it kind of collapses in on itself. Ah, yes. Here's a familiar face. This also is a, you know, kind of an attempt to take this process of building as the design principle, rather than a drawing, right? Rather than starting from a drawing, to just start from the building. And maybe there's a kind of system there. As I look at it now, it's a little hard to identify exactly what that was. But the process of constructing this determined kind of its extent, and
Oscar, that means there was no sketch, no drawings before you started this construction?
No, I think I think the model came after the structure, as far as I remember. You know, I had a space at this time. I was working in Paris, and it was a squat at Pont de Sèvres, this old ceramic factory, which I had a small space in, and then outside we had an outdoor space, and were able to build there. And so there are two links of these pine beams. And I think I just, you know, began with this very rough idea of a kind of rectangular module, and built it in various different configurations intersecting one another. And then the model afterwards is a way to kind of preserve that configuration.
Is it found material?
Not found. I mean, it is, in the sense that it's like off the shelf, you know. This was something that yeah, I took kind of standard lengths, but it was new material from, you know, from the shop, from the mill. And you can see there in Winterthur, it's now somewhat aged and has quite a different appearance, which I quite like. This is a project also with my brother Eli, and this was a kind of a single module, a single platform, a stage for something to happen. And you can see it's got like a lamp there, and a solar panel. And so, and then it's got a bench, and inside the bench is like the whole, the battery system for the solar power. And the thought was just that this was something that, activates at night and that can kind of be, an open question in public space for something else to happen. One feature of this structure, which I think is quite funny, is there's, you see there near the bench, there's this kind of wet spot on the floor. And that was an intentionally designed, like, low spot in the structure so that it would collect water. Really, I guess, contrary to what you would want in any kind of building. But I thought it's interesting to have this like standing water as a, like a poetic element in the structure somehow, that can reflect the light. And it's maybe one of the first times that I was using water in a building. There's I'm looking for the word. It's, you know, water is uncontainable, and and it introduces an element of kind of maybe what it is actually is that it just dissolves the boundaries, the conventional boundaries of a work of art, that it, that like water is everywhere, and once there's water within an artwork, then it's connected to everything outside of it or something like that. It's another building project from my apartment in Paris. Like, at the time, my family and I, we had an apartment that had a little guest room, or, you know, a little guest bedroom, which I took over as my studio. And then I wanted to have a place where people could come and spend the night still. And so I built this bed in the center. You can see it's got like three panels that lift up, and there's a bed inside there. And then this kind of, very DIY couch furniture built around it, and a floor, and it was a way of kind of thinking about furniture and architectural interior also as a kind of sculptural space to work. And, you know, in all of these works, there's the presence of like bodies and movement, and the potential for other things to happen is really important to me. Like, using sculpture as a platform or as a stage, or in this case, literally as a, like a catwalk. This was for the Whitney Biennial, maybe in 2011 or something. good friend of mine, the artist Kate Hardy, had an idea to do a fashion show. And Kate is a radical queer feminist performance artist doing something with clothes that's like, that is fashion, but it's so much more than that. It's a kind of sculptural performance-based expression of the body in motion. And so I asked her if I could design the catwalk, and I look at it now and I think, wow, it's really like the least functional catwalk that I could have designed. Really treacherous with these stairs, especially for the models walking in high heels. And then it's got this kind of like elevated walkway. And it was activated during her performance and then reconfigured in another orientation in another gallery. So like, it was also something that had no clear definitive form, that was transforming a structure in transformation. For the Venice Biennial, I was invited by Beecher Kiriger to do a para pavilion. This great idea of like she invited several artists to do extra pavilions, you know, kind of like between the national pavilions, to somehow also complicate that format of the national pavilion. And so I conceived this structure again, like as a kind of structure formed in collapse. Here, the one on the left is two sort of tabletop forms that were designed and built as vertical structures and then tipped against one another until they collapsed into a state of equilibrium, which was this kind of really exciting adventure in improvised engineering. And it worked. And through the corners, you can enter this space, which feels like it's, you know, kind of structure and suspended collapse. And then next to it is this other structure, again, like kind of relying on a living tree as its structural support. And both of them together, you know, I mean, the structure on the tree really is just a platform, a stage, a place for something else to happen. And it did host several events. The artist Patty Smith gave a little concert there. My friend Carl Holmquist gave a poetry reading. And on the back side of the structure, I don't think I have a photo of that, Ida Ekblad painted a mural. And so thinking about this structure as kind of a place for other things to happen, and a host structure, a platform. This is a, yeah, maybe kind of like a new type of sport that I invented. I really think about it as like the quintessential New York play structure. There's the basketball hoop and the handball wall. These two like quintessential Brooklyn sports. This is in Brooklyn Bridge Park. And here they're like brought together and intersecting around a tree, and bringing these two separate activities into close proximity. I like this idea of a kind of potential third sport emerging between the two activities. And then maybe also as something that kind of like appears and disappears in public space, that depending on one's knowledge of it, or one's perception of it, that something can either appear as a natural element, like a tree, or a park furniture or a sculpture, and it doesn't really matter in a sense, like those, and in fact, like all of those perceptions are simultaneously possible or possible like at different times depending on our interaction with it. So this is a really subtle piece. It was like at that same time as the basketball hoop piece. It's a fountain with two small holes drilled through the trunk of the tree, and a water pump concealed underneath the ground. So like when you look at it, it's always raining. It's always wet. It's got its own weather system. But it's quite subtle. It's just kind of trickling down the bark of the tree.
Oscar, I just have a question for these two images before. These trees. So you selected these trees in a wood, or and then mm-hmm. treated them to be a part of the sculpture. So this is a selection of trees that become sculpture.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they're not actually trees that were in the park. The park was quite new at that time, and it just opened. The Brooklyn Bridge Park, I think, you know, this amount have opened in 2010 or 12 or something like that. It's around that time. And so there weren't a lot of mature trees, but I found trees elsewhere and brought them in and used them as sculptural elements. This is similar kind of work, but it actually uses a combination of existing trees and one tree that was imported. That it was a really interesting situation here. Next to a stream, you can see the stream kind of running behind the structure, and there's this like almost vertical wall of pine trees on the hill across. So it's kind of a dark site and quite wooded. And I thought to make something that is really imbricated and relies on that site. So I started working with the trees and built this structure, this concrete structure that might be kind of the beginning of some kind of architecture, the beginning of a building or a pavilion, but that relies on the trees for support. There are two trees that it connects to, one to the right and the other, the one that's kind of in the center to the left, is a locust tree that was harvested from a site nearby. And brought in to kind of like complete that section of the module. And the funny story about that is like, it was cut down and planted in the ground, you know, in a base of concrete that was 2 meters deep, and, you know, probably 3 meter diameter, just this huge block of concrete, and then set into this structure that supports it. And then like 6 months later, it was still sprouting new leaves out of it. I just found that kind of fascinating, that it had a kind of afterlife. And, you know, simultaneous to all this, like working outside, I'm always interested in the space of exhibition as this kind of space of abstraction, and and one of the things I just became like really fascinated in for years was the architectonics of walls, right? So like walls, I mean, at least in the American context, since like the turn of the 20th century, walls have been built, you know, balloon framing, it's called, is kind of like the typical way of stud building. The building that you're sitting in right now is built with a system of 2x4 or 2x6 wood or steel studs, and then it's clad with, like, you know, in, you know, exterior materials, or in the case of interior walls, it's clad with plasterboard. And plasterboard also is this like really recent invention, from, you know, the 1920s, and it enables the construction of like rapid construction of these really smooth, seamless walls. But what's inside there? Like what's in that space inside the wall? That kind of became really fascinating to me as a space of imagination, space of potential, this kind of like unseen space at the center of all of architecture, really. And so there, you know, along with that, I was thinking about thresholds and passageways, and like passing through walls. What does it mean to pass through a wall? What does it mean to walk through walls, right? And so in a very kind of flat-footed, mundane way, I started to build these doorways, thresholds, structures that dramatize that a little bit, that like make you feel the strangeness of walking through a wall. And of course, you know, as an artist, I think it's, we're always like making cover versions of the things that come before us. I'm fascinated with this idea of like of a cover version, and taking works that I love and recreating them like in my own way and trying to bring something new to that. This, of course, is the iconic Scott Burton chair, and his is in granite. Mine is in cast concrete, and just a nice way of like paying homage to work that is important to me, and inhabiting it and trying to work in that space. Also in the space of the building, doubling, you know, this idea also of like a double, like the cover version, is a way of using an existing element as a mirror in a way. So this is at the Museum Ludwig in Cologne, and there was several elements to this installation, but one of the things that I became fascinated with was this outdoor terrace and the revolving door that led to it. Just behind the work here, you can see through the glass is this revolving door, and it's an architectural element that I wanted to recreate like by hand. And so took it apart as a drawing, created a architectural drawing of this element and took it apart piece by piece, kind of disassembled it, dismantled it, and rebuilt it as a freestanding structure, then with like an additional infrastructural support around it that acts as this mirror somehow, that like when you walk out, the original revolving door, you go in a circle again and walk again through this second door leading to nowhere. Yeah, that's Castillo Corrales. That's a gallery space, exhibition space that I started with a few friends in Paris, in Belleville. And it was a space for, it started as an office space where we were working, and then we kind of started making exhibitions there, and that took over. And it was a way of like, for me, it was a way of working for other artists and like executing their work with them, for them. And the space was very small, really tiny, but constantly being rebuilt and used for various different purposes. It eventually kind of morphed into a bookstore. And this you can see at the beginning of that process, Castillo Corrales, Section 7 Books, and Paraguay Press, all kind of cohabitating that space. This again is a platform, a structure of some kind to host another activity, and also related to books or to literature, to poetry. This is a structure at the sculpture park, I guess you could call it, of Stephen Hall, the architect. He has a space where he invites artists, and interestingly, he invites artists and poets. So I did this structure there and invited my dear friend Cedar Saigo, who's a poet, to come and read and to kind of inhabit this space as a kind of, you'll see also in Winterthur there, there's this other aluminum structure, maybe of a similar genealogy, this structure that is incomplete, but has the potential maybe of the space for one person. Going back to this idea of Onulife and like what are the bare minimum conditions of architecture, what constitutes shelter? There we go. A structure that is the bare bones of architecture and that remains in a state of kind of incompletion that needs to be completed in our mind. I wonder how we're doing on time, actually. I should.
Well, if you want to open for questions, maybe we should. Yeah, well, maybe this, Ampon, and then maybe opening for questions.
Yeah, great. Perfect. So this is in Belfort in France, just across the border there from Switzerland, a town that was liberated in November of 1944 by the Commandos d'Afrique. That was like a expeditionary fighting force that left Algier and fought across Italy and France, and it was kind of this neglected aspect of the history of the war that hadn't really been memorialized properly. And so I was invited to this amazing program, Nouveaux Commanditaires, which is like a way that citizens or citizen groups of citizens can commission artists, and so the call was for a memorial to the Commandos d'Afrique through a community of an Algerian community there in Belfort. And so my proposal was to kind of think first about like that relationship between Belfort, which is itself a kind of like important military site, and the Lion de Belfort is this kind of like icon there of the fortress of Belfort, and then Algier, where this group started from. And so the bridge is this kind of intersection of these two sight lines, one to the Lion de Belfort and the other like the longer potential bridge to Algier, and just like what that the intersection of those two points, what that implies. And and of course, you know, using wood as a material for memorial is kind of atypical, but for me it was really important as a way of like insisting that this is a living memory and that it requires care, it requires maintenance and the support and engagement and care of the community that commissioned it. So it's something that may be temporary or may be you know, perpetual, depending on kind of the memorial function that exists there. So but yeah, let's go ahead and open it for questions if there are any.
Let's wait a second. Hat jemand
eine Frage? Oder etwas, was unklar war, oder etwas, was euch gefehlt hat, oder etwas, wo ihr einen Bezug noch herstellen möchtet zwischen dem, was ihr gesehen habt, hier auf dem Screen und in der Ausstellung.
Oder auch einen Bezug zwischen dem, was ihr aufgeschrieben habt, als Eindruck, den ihr von der Ausstellung hattet, zu dem, was gesagt wurde.
Oder vielleicht praktische Fragen, wie er dazu kommt, all das zu realisieren.
Aber mir war es die Inspiration, war das so für das Objekt. Oder ob das der Anfang war mit dem ersten Bild, wie da gekommen ist, auf diese Art, diese Punkte.
So one question is, about the scale of the works and how it became, I mean, you create very large work, and how the size of the work, what's the importance there? Or does it have to be so big to say what you want to say with it?
No, and in fact, like, you know, this is a selection of maybe the larger stuff in a lot of ways. I'm also interested in this scale of furniture somehow. And so there's really a kind of a spectrum. Although, you know, I think there's something, I mean, what I like to say or think is that, like, I work at human scale, which is like both like the human scale of building something that can be built, you know, with, you know, human power somehow. And then like the scale of the body. And so that does vary, you know, I mean, I think, you know, this is another example of something, yeah, it is quite large. It's a big cast concrete stove. But there's a sense of intimacy in the work that I think is kind of like maybe the most important to me, more than scale. That these are objects that are meant to be touched and meant to be like used in some sense. That can offer something like warmth or shelter or and then you know, the structure that you're sitting in, that's kind of a new scale for me. It's the model scale, it's half scale, and there's something really different that happens in that scale, I think, that it's based on a structure that's twice that size. And so to scale it down, I think creates something kind of accessible. It's interesting.
So how do you go about choosing your materials? I think you already talked about it for the monuments in Belfort.
Yeah, I think, you know, I mean, using the vocabulary of construction, it's always been interesting to me just to kind of use the fundamentals of steel and concrete. But lately, I really am much more interested in working with wood. I mean, there's definitely an environmental consequence to working with concrete that I'm a little bit less excited about at the moment. And wood is like, there's a kind of, you know, infinite variety of wood applications. But particularly right now, what's possible with engineered wood, you know, you think about, like, I think in Winterthur, actually, there's planned to be one of the largest, if not the largest, wooden skyscraper planned in the next few years. And this kind of potential is really exciting to me. It is a sustainable material, and it kind of bridges the gap between sculpture and architecture in a really elegant way for me. You know, that it can go from a carving to a structural element, and all phases in between, you know.
Okay, is there a
question? Yeah, no, I think we have to.
All right. So thank you so much, Oscar, for all these insights in your work. That was a great pleasure, and thank you so much, and speak soon.
Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you.
Great to see you all there. Have a good day.